Sunday morning, October 3rd, 1574, the 109th day of siege by the Spanish army. At the moment, there is no change in the situation as we reported it last night. The expected Spanish attack has not yet developed, delayed no doubt by a murky yellow fog that has rolled in from the sea. The ships of the Dutch fleet, manned by the gallant beggars of the sea and loaded with food for the starving people of Leiden, are still pinned down a few miles to the south by shallow water and the guns of the Spanish-held Fort Lamen. Meantime, here in Leiden, a large crowd of desperate men, women, and children is gathering in an ominous demonstration at the Stadhuis, the burgomaster's office in the center of the town. So at the moment here in Leiden, the three critical questions are, when will the Spanish attack? When will the fleet be able to move again towards Leiden? And how much longer can the war-weary, starving people of this besieged city remain steadfast?
October 3rd, 1574. The city of Leiden in the Netherlands. You are there.
Leiden, a city under siege. CBS takes you back 375 years to the agonies of a people struggling for independence and freedom from Spanish rule. All things are as they were then, except for one thing. When CBS is there,
you are there.
You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyenne, is based on authentic historical fact and quotation. And now,
Holland, the Wall of Leiden, and John Daly.
Decision on this, the 109th day of its agonizing siege. The first report we had of the demonstration before the Stadhuis came just a few moments ago, and immediately Don Hollenbeck left in the mobile unit for the center of the town. As soon as he's on the scene, we'll have a report from him. We'll know just why the demonstrators are gathering. Of course, it's not difficult to speculate on what's behind the demonstration. It's probably an expression of the intense disappointment into which this city has been plunged by the tragedy of yesterday's events. Yesterday, hopes were soaring in Leiden. Relief and food seemed finally at hand. The beggars of the sea, the Dutch fleet, after 3 months of struggling over flooded country to reach Leiden, sailed through the last dike that rings the city. The fleet, the food barges, were within sight of these walls, and the people gathered here on the walls, cheering, singing, offering up prayers of thanks for their deliverance. And then suddenly the wind shifted, the water ran back through that opening in the dike, and the beggars of the sea, with their precious cargo of food and medical supplies, were grounded in less than a foot of water. From the very peak of exhilaration, the people of Leiden were plunged into blackest despair. There's been no sleep in Leiden this night, no hope, only depression and deep gloom. Don Hollenbeck has reached the Stadhuis in the center of the city, so go ahead, Don Hollenbeck.
Several hundred men, women, and children have come into the square before the Stadhuis. Others continue to arrive. Some of them are so weak they crawl on their hands and knees. The square, however, is rapidly filling up. These people have reached a point of utter desperation. They want food. They must have food, even if it means surrender to the Spanish. They want food. Burgomaster van der Werf has sent word out. He'll talk to them in a few moments. They're waiting for him now to appear. This is a demonstration almost without noise, a mute gathering of people who've sustained just about as much agony, as much suffering, as the human spirit can endure. The failure of the Dutch fleet to bring food to the city yesterday, its grounding in the mud of the flooded Dutch countryside, seems to have taken all the heart out of these people. One of the demonstrators here is Mrs. Jan Richter. Mrs. Richter tells me her husband is a miller.
With the militia on the city wall.
Mrs. Richter and her husband and family fled to England 2 years ago to escape religious persecution. I've been speaking with Mrs. Richter. She tells me they returned to Leiden only after the city went over to the cause of Prince William.
Food. We must have food. Yesterday, my neighbor's baby died. Today will be my baby. I cannot stand it any longer. that we had for days. From the trees, we'd take the leaves and bark, boil it into soup. We searched the gutters, dunghill, for something, anything. But there is nothing.
I'm so sorry, Mrs. Richter. Nothing. We won't try your strength anymore. We understand Mrs. Richter has already lost two of her children.
Yeah. They were sick. They were too weak from hunger to get well. I have given enough. Why should I give more?
Mrs. Richter is walking away into the crowd. Burgomaster van der Werf hasn't appeared yet. So back to John Daly on the Wall of Leiden.
There's still no sign of an attack by the Spanish, and the fog still is hanging like some wet, heavy shroud over the flooded countryside. There's no hint of a breeze, nothing here but silence and grim, hungry men watching and waiting. The approach of the Dutch fleet and the breaking of the dikes has made the Spanish position at Fort Lamon untenable from a military point of view. Once the wind shifts, sooner or later it must. The water will rise and cut off the Spanish garrison from the main body of Spanish troops that are to the west. Their best hope now, then, is to attack Leiden. Attack while the Dutch fleet is immobilized. Take the city and entrench themselves securely behind the city walls. If the Spanish do attack, if Leiden falls, with it will fall all hopes for Dutch independence and freedom from Spain. For Leiden has become a testing ground. Prince William of Orange, the leader of the Dutch resistance, has solemnly committed himself to bring relief to this tortured city. If he can do it, then the will of the Dutch people to resist will be revived. But if he fails, then the other Dutch cities will probably feel that the fight is hopeless. They almost certainly will quit the struggle and accept Spanish rule. The gravity of the present situation is emphasized by the fact that Prince William himself came aboard the Dutch fleet late last night. Ken Roberts aboard the fleet reports that the Prince has agreed to speak with us, so we switch you now to the Beggars of the Sea and Ken Roberts.
Prince William of Orange will be with us shortly. Right now he is in Admiral Boisseau's cabin in consultation with his senior officers. Here aboard the fleet, stretched out on deck, huddled under every spare stitch of canvas and covering, the Beggars of the Sea are getting what rest they can before the action of the day begins. These Dutch patriots, many of them carrying wounds from previous battles with the Spaniards, are from every corner, every hamlet of Holland. Some of them haven't seen their homes and families for 5 years or more. They've been sailing as freebooters and privateers in a ceaseless and bloody campaign against Spanish shipping. The term beggars, as you know, as applied to the Dutch partisans, stems back to an incident that occurred 9 years ago when 300 Dutch noblemen petitioned Margaret, Duchess of Parma, the sister of King Philip of Spain, for relief from persecution by the Spanish-imposed Inquisition. At that time, one of Margaret's courtiers haughtily advised the Duchess that she had nothing to fear from such a band of beggars. But proudly, in a later conference, the Dutch nobles took the name beggars, and when Prince William granted some of his followers commissions as privateers, these freebooters grimly applied the term beggars of the sea to their forces. I see that Prince William has just come out of the Admiral's cabin. He has paused a moment to talk to some of the sailors gathered here on deck. The Prince looks very pale. The effect of his recent illness is very apparent. He had no sleep at all last night. He is dressed completely in black, in mourning for his four brothers who have died in this struggle for Dutch independence. Prince William is ready to talk to us now.
I am ready now.
Yes, Your Highness, will you wait for the wind to change and the water to rise, or would you order your troops and sailors to leave the ships and attempt to bring food to Leiden on foot?
We will wait for the wind.
Well, suppose the fog lifts and the Spanish attack Leiden before the wind shifts and the water rises.
In that case, of course, we will attack the Spanish on foot.
But, Your Highness, that would mean that your troops on foot
and struggling through the water, would then be exposed to the Spanish fire from the fort.
We will not. We cannot stand by and see our brothers lie that slaughtered, our sisters' wives raped by these Spanish beasts. We will do what we can. We're doomed to perish in the name of God, be it so.
Prince William, you know, of course, that the Spanish Governor General, Don Luis de Requesen, has renewed his offer of amnesty to the people of Leiden if they open the gates of the city to the Spanish.
And if they accept the Catholic faith.
Yes. Well, do you think, in view of the desperate condition of the city, that his offer may be accepted?
A Spanish promise is like a Spanish pepper. It burns whomsoever shall taste it. We saw the value of the Spanish promise at Harlem. That he opened its gates to the Spanish and the people were massacred. Amnesty. Here's what we Dutch think of the Spanish promise of amnesty. Since Don Luis made the first offer to the people of Holland, and that was 4 months ago, since then two people, just two, in all the Netherlands, have come forward to accept it. One a brewer in Utrecht, the other the son of a peddler from Leiden.
But, Your Highness, you must admit that at times men will accept any promise of relief, even though they know it may be false.
I have the quality of faith in Leiden that Leiden has in me. When the siege began, I swore to bring relief to the city. The people of Leiden know I will keep my word. By my orders, the dikes were cut, bordered with fruitful pastures, land reclaimed by the toil of centuries, blooming gardens and rich orchards was given back to the and none opposed the sacrifice. Not a single farmer who saw his crops sucked down by the waves. Not one opposed it. When the Spanish saw what we were doing, when they saw our fleet sail over the land, they sneered and they laughed. And they said to the people of Leiden, it will be easier to pluck the stars from the sky than sail a fleet to the gates of Leiden. Well, we're here. We are here. With God's help, we shall maintain our promise. Leiden shall be relieved.
Okay.
Yeah, Louis.
Well, Admiral Bordeaux has just come over. You're talking to Prince William.
And you have heard, sir. We have good news. Admiral Bordeaux tells me that the wind is shifting. Water is rising. There are things I must attend to.
Thank you, Your Highness. That's the news, the good news. I can feel the freshening of the wind. It is shifting, definitely. It's shifting, and the fog is thinning out. Now the decks here have burst into action, and the men are climbing up into the rigging. I can't say how long it will be before we can begin to move.
This is John Daly on the Leiden city wall. We've interrupted Ken Roberts because the Burgomaster has appeared on the balcony of the Stadthuis where the people are demonstrating before the city hall. Go ahead, Don Hollenbeck.
Burgomaster van der Werf has appeared on the balcony of the Stadthuis. This crowd makes almost no move. Only a few voices cry out. Most of these people simply stare up at the Burgomaster in mute, tragic appeal, begging him with their eyes to give them food. Now the Burgomaster is speaking.
Dat hij onze belofte niet breken en de stad overgeven aan de Spanjaarden. Dan wacht haar een verschrikkelijker lot dan de ellende die ze nu te verduren heeft.
What do you want, my friends, the Burgomaster has said. Do you want me to surrender to the Spaniards a fate more horrible than we now endure?
Sterven kan ik slechts eenmaal. Het zij door uw handen, door de vijand of door Gods hand.
I have sworn to hold the city, van der Werf said. I can die but once, at your hands, at the enemy's, or by the hand of God.
Boven de smadelijke dood, die ons van de Spanjaarden wacht.
I don't care what happens to me. Starvation is better than a dishonorable death.
Moet er ontzet worden. Maar uw dreigkreten raken mij niet. Over mijn leven kunt gij beschikken. Hier is mijn zwaard. Steek het in mijn borst.
Your threats don't move me, the Burgomaster said. Here's my sword. Plunge it into my breast.
Maar verwacht geen overgave. Zolang ik in leven ben.
Divide my flesh, take my body to appease your hunger, but expect no surrender so long as I remain alive.
And omkomen in de vlag. Voelt ge de wind? Ziet ge draaien? Het komt nu uit zuid. En het zal ons de prins brengen. En voedsel. En
the Burgomaster has raised his arms and said, do you feel comes from the south. With it will come our prince, food, and freedom. The bells, the alarm bells are ringing. Once more, the burgomaster. To the walls, the burgomaster cried. All men to the walls. Why do you hesitate? The Spanish are coming. The bells signal the attack. Will you meet them here prostrate, or will you meet them at the walls like Dutchmen? And as if fetched off by some spark, this crowd has come to life. It's picking up the rallying call of the burgomaster, shouting out the slogan of the Dutch Revolution, "Long live the beggars." And now the men are rushing off to the city wall, so back to John Daly.
The Spanish are not attacking, but the city wall is crumbling. The rising water has undermined the base of the wall, and huge cracks have appeared in a section of the wall directly in line with Fort Lamon, the most vulnerable part of the defenses. The commander of the Dutch militia, Jan van der Does, has ordered every man to the crumbling wall. They're attempting to shore it up with timber and sandbags. But right before our eyes, the cracks are widening, spreading. Is calling the men back. A section of the wall is giving way. It's tumbling over. It's falling. The wall has been breached. A gaping 16-foot hole has been opened up in the city wall. The brick and mortar gave way and spilled forward onto the flooded pasture before the wall. And now, at a command from van der Does, the men are springing into action, manning the breach, wheeling cannon into that gaping hole. But so far, the Spanish are not attacking. They're not yet exploiting this break in the city's defense. Looking across to Fort Lamon, we see no signs of the Spanish. And it's anxious looks that are being thrown over in that direction now with this new disaster that has faced this starving city. The fog has lifted a bit. We can see the very crown of the fortress hidden in the mist, but still, strain as we will, we see no sign of any activity at all in the Spanish-held fort of Lamon. Nothing at all yet. Here in the city, from the streets, from every section of the city, men are running toward the wall, up the ramp, taking their defense position. Some of them have muskets, but most of them are armed only with swords, with long knives, pitchforks, anything and everything that might stand as a weapon. And anything and everything will be needed if the Spaniards now begin to spill out of Lamon and make attack on this weakened section of the city wall. The switch of the wind has brought the water rushing towards the wall in waves. It's rising here, rising by the minute. Ken Roberts, aboard the Dutch fleet, can you see the break in the wall, Ken? Does the Admiral know that a section of the wall is gone?
Yes, John. We can see the breach in the wall from here. The water is pouring in from the open dike in a flood. And here, most of the ships and the food barges are already free, off the mud. But the Ark of Delft, the famous huge Dutch warship, the heavily armed spearhead of this fleet, the Ark of Delft is still held fast because of its enormous weight. And, of course, the fleet can't move without the guns and armament of the Ark of Delft. Now the crew of the gunboat, along with many of the men from the other ships of the fleet here, have gone over the side, and they're waist deep in the water. They're pulling, hauling on hawsers attached to the Ark of Delft. It's free. The Ark of Delft is free, and its crew is climbing back on board now. I can see the hand-operated paddle wheels beginning to move. The sails are set. We're moving forward. We're on our way. Food, relief is moving forward to Leyden.
This is John Daly. There's a report here that the Spanish have abandoned Fort Lamon. I'll repeat that. It has been reported, unconfirmed, that the Spanish have abandoned Fort Lamon. Now, this is what has happened. Just a few moments ago, a 12-year-old boy named Cornelis Joppins was brought to the commander of the militia by his father. The boy is being questioned now by the burgomaster and by Commander van der Does. He claims that late last night, while he was acting as a lookout on one of the breastworks here on the wall, he saw a swarm of sparks leaving the fort along the road that leads west towards the coast and the Spanish-held city of The Hague, but away from Leyden.
The sparks he mentioned might well have been the lit fuses that soldiers carry to fire their muskets. If the report is true, it means that the Spaniards under pressure decided that their position at Fort Laman was untenable and that they have secretly retreated during the night.
Open boat, burgemeester. This is Echtweier. Get this in, John.
It is a godswonder. What is it? What van jij ervan, Van der Doef?
The boy keeps on insisting that his story is true. Now Commander Bungadoor is speaking.
Om het af te slachten.
Maar de jongen houdt vol dat hij ze weg zag trekken.
Get her seen.
The commander insists it's a trap, a ruse to get the people outside the protection of the wall.
Een godswonder is het, man. Waarachter. Godswerk.
Als je me deze bolder geeft, dan wil ik er zelf in heen.
But the youngster still claims the Spanish are gone and he's offered to go into the fort alone for 6 guilders. He wants to prove he's right.
Is het de valstrik, dan verliezen we...
The burgemeester is willing, but van der Does has objected. He says the boy is walking into the trap, and now the burgemeester again.
Nou, dadelijk, zonder dat we behoeven te wachten. En iedere minuut betekent een mensenleven.
Maar goed, ik heb vrijwilligers nodig om deze jongen naar het fort te gooien. Nou, wie wil?
And the boy is going. The boy is going. 3 men have just volunteered to row him across to the fort. The burgomaster argued that whether the Spaniards had gone or not, it was necessary to know the absolute truth, because if the Spanish are really gone, then food can be rushed to Leiden that much faster. And the situation here is so desperate now that actually minutes mean lives. And the sooner the food arrives, the more lives will be saved. The 3 volunteers and Cornelis Guppen, the youngster, are making their way down a ramp that leads to a little landing. The people here who have heard the interrogation of the young Guppen's boy are naturally excited. The youngster and the 3 volunteers are now getting into a boat. Meantime, the commander and the burgomaster have gone to their headquarters post on the wall, and signal flags are being hoisted. It's evidently a communication of some kind out to the fleet. The fog has not completely lifted. There are gaps through it, though, and through these gaps we can catch glimpses of the fleet. Ken Roberts, are the beggars of the sea getting the signal?
Yes, John. Yes, we can see the flags clearly now. The fog is almost gone.
Well, what's the impression in the fleet, Ken? Do they think the Spaniards are gone?
Well, John, there's as much confusion here about all this as there is in Leiden. But this much is clear, John. Spaniards or no Spaniards, the beggars of the sea are determined to get these food barges into Leiden. They're crowding on the canvas now. The men are working like slaves at the oars. And the fleet is pulling its way through the water, and within seconds we'll be within firing range of the fort.
Well, everybody here is praying, Ken, that the boy's story is true. There won't be any firing, that the food barges are actually going to get through. The 3 volunteers in the rowboat now are out about halfway towards the fort. Little Cornelis is standing up in the front of the boat looking ahead, his hair blowing wildly in the breeze, a small figure, resolute and determined. Ahead of them, and as we're looking out across the water, we see looming the solid mass of the fort, jutting out of the water like some evil giant cannon pointed outward towards the oncoming fleet, towards those food barges which are loaded with corn and wheat and beef. If the big Spanish guns should open fire, those barges are going to be splintered like so many matchsticks, and their precious cargo will end up in the sea. Off in the distance, we can see the beggars of the sea approaching, this approaching Dutch fleet on which our hopes are so heavily based. Their sails are full. You can see the oars sweeping in rhythm. And now the fleet is within range of the fort, but, well, so far there's not a gun has spoken, not a shot of any kind. The little rowboat is almost up to the fort. The men at the oars are pulling strongly against the flowing tide. Cornelis is standing up at the front. He's still looking steadily towards the fort, and all the eyes here are on the fort. The men are standing on the ramparts of the city wall, disregarding their own personal safety, clear targets for the Spaniards, something they wouldn't dare to have to do just as recently as yesterday. And some of the men have even raised their children on their shoulders as their women stand by their sides, by the sides of their husbands, their sons, and their brothers, watching the fort looking into that mass of silence that stands between them and fools, between Leiden and the beggars of the sea. The rowboat has reached the port. Cornelis Juppens has caught onto an overhanging ledge, and he's swinging himself up over the ledge, right onto an iron chain that extends down from an opening in the side of the port. He's as agile as a little monkey. Hand over hand, he's going up. The men of the boat have pulled over under the protection of the ledge, but Cornelis is up now, right up to the opening. He stops for a moment, looks this way, and waves. He's smiling and waving, and now he's disappeared into the fort. He's gone. Well, now there's nothing to do but wait. Wait and see. The fleet is near, very near. We can make out the coat of arms of the House of Orange painted on the sails, and we can see the bare backs of the galleymen as they rock back and forth in time to the count of the boatswain in the stern, but there's still no sound from Fort Laman, not a sound, not a shot. There's only a ghostly, almost unearthly silence. If this is a trap, if this really is a trap, it's ready to be strung, or rather be sprung within the minute, almost within seconds, for now the food barges are almost abreast of... There he is! At the top of the fort, on the topmost rampant, Cornelis Juppens, and he's waving to us. It's called the Spanish Argon. The fort is empty. The people here on the walls are going wild with excitement. They're cheering and weeping, clawing at one another in hysterical joy, and there goes one of Leiden's guns signaling the good news to the fleet, and the guns on the fleet are answering in chorus. Listen! Over, and the 109 days of torture and heroic resistance is ended. The food barges are sweeping past the fort, coming right up to the city wall. In a matter of moments, there'll be...
October 3rd, 1574. The siege of Leiden is lifted, and the Dutch fight on to eventual independence and freedom from Spain.
You have been listening to The Siege of Leiden, another broadcast in the series You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyenne. The Siege of Leiden was written by Irv Tunick and Mr. Cheyenne. The cast included Inga Adams, Michael Ingram, Benjamin Hunninger, Guy Sorrell, Ronnie Liss, Abe Vigoda, and others. Next week...
April 26, 1865, Garrett's Farm, Virginia. The capture of John Wilkes Booth. You are there.
Our Miss Brooks, America's favorite schoolmistress, entertains you every Sunday night on CBS with some of the gayest, freshest comedy to be found in radio. With Eve Arden of Hollywood starring as the lass who charms everyone but the man of her heart, the strong, handsome biology teacher, you'll really want to go back to school when Our Miss Brooks rings the bell for her Sunday evening classes. Eve Arden, starring as Our Miss Brooks, is heard over most of these same CBS stations, as is Helen Hayes, the star of Columbia's Sunday Night Electric Theater. Hear them tonight. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.